Basketball is a game most known and loved. For those who don't know the definition of basketball is a game played between two teams of five players, each on a rectangular court, and is usually indoors. Each team tries to score by tossing the ball through the opponent's goal, an elevated horizontal hoop, and a net called a basket. Basketball, a sport of strictly U.S. origin, was created by a man named James Naismith on or about December 1st, 1891. James was born on November 6, 1861, in Almonte, Ontario, Canada, to his Scottish parents. Born on a farm, he spent his days outside playing catch, hide-and-seek, or duck on a rock, a game in which a player guards a large Drake stone from opposing players who try to knock it down. By throwing smaller rocks at it, he soon found out playing duck on a rock, a soft lobbing shot, was way better than a straight hard throw. This was an essential discovery for the invention of shot clock, for the invention of basketball. He attended elementary and grade school at Benny's Corners near Almonte in his early life. He then attended Almonte High School in Almonte, Ontario, and graduated in 1883. In the same year, he started college at McGill University in Montreal. Although described as scrawny, standing at 5'10 and listed at 178 pounds, he was a versatile and talented athlete, playing football, lacrosse, rugby, soccer, and gymnastics for the school. He earned his Bachelor of Arts degree in physical education in 1888 and a diploma at the Presbyterian College in Montreal in 1890.
From 1888 to 1890, Naismith taught physical education and became the first McGill Director of Athletics. But after, he left Montreal to study at the YMCA International Training School in Springfield, Massachusetts. After completing the YMCA Physical Director Training Program, he received an order from Dr. Luther Golick, the head of physical education there. It was to make an indoor game that would provide quote-unquote athletic distraction. It was also required to not take up that much space, and it would be enough activity to keep his track athletes in shape. When tasked with this, he finalized it into two thoughts. First, he analyzed the most popular sports at the time. He saw that most contact happened while running with the ball, dribbling, or hitting it. He decided that the best option was passing to reduce contact. Second, he didn't want the goal to be guardable, so he decided that putting it high above the player's head was the best option.
On November 22, 1950, the Fort Wayne Pistons played the Minneapolis Lakers. The 7,021 fans who gathered there had reduced to a small, irritated crowd, and boos echoed throughout the stadium. For most of the 48 minutes, which is how long a basketball game is, it was the Pistons' possessions. Players, fans, and even referees tried to encourage them to score, but the ball was just aimlessly floating around the court. In a last-ditch effort, the Lakers resorted to fouling the Pistons to get the ball back. The Lakers coach at the time, Coach Johnny Condla, stated, "Play like that will kill professional basketball." This game ended in the lowest scoring game in 19-18, ending in the lowest scoring game in NBA history. Danny Biasone, on February 22, 1909, was born in a town called Miglianico in Italy. Emil Barboni, born to Augusto and Antonio Barboni in a town called Onondaga, just outside of Syracuse, New York, in 1950. Leo Ferris was born in Elmira, New York. What did these three have in common? Their love for basketball, and they didn't want to see the game fail. In the spring of 1954, those three men were tasked with saving the NBA by solving the game's fatal flaw. It was too slow, and they were losing fans very fast.
The three men had a conversation in Eastwood Sports Center, a bowling alley / coffee shop owned by Danny Biasone. This conversation eventually led to the creation of the shot clock. At the time, he also owned the Syracuse Nationals. This conversation and development of the shot clock made the game a more fast-paced and exciting game to watch. Fans, finally given what they were begging for, would slowly start to rise as the game had been saved by the three men. Biasone came up with the 24-second idea while studying previous games. He realized both teams on average would take about 60 shots per game. He thought doubling that to 120 shots per game would kill the boredom of how slow the game it was. So, if you shoot the ball every 24 seconds over the course of 48 minutes, how long a basketball game was, it would add up to 120 shots. After coming up with the idea, he tried to sell it to the other owners of the league for 3 years. But after a few exhibition matches, the 24-second shot clock was adopted in the 1954-1955 season.
With the new shot clock in the league, the game was more interesting to watch, with over 20,000 fans showing up to the opening game. The game was played in New York when the Minneapolis Lakers played the New York Knicks. The New York Knicks came up with an upset against the defending champs as the final score was 94-83, making it over 150 points scored in a game. The implementation of the shot clock became one of the most important ideas to ever be added to the game of basketball. Just thinking, what would have happened if those three guys would have never met in the bowling alley to change the game of basketball forever?
Well, one thing is certain is that the NBA has evolved into a year-round, universally recognized American organization. The game's biggest stars, LeBron James, Kevin Durant, and Steph Curry, spar for 48 minutes as superstars like Chris Rock, Snoop Dogg, and Packers quarterback Aaron Rodgers take in the insane plays these Titans make while sitting in six-figure courtside seats. LeBron nails an off-balance jumper over Durant's protruding arms, and at the 6-minute, 24-27-second mark of the first quarter, Cleveland has already hit the 19-point mark that spawned the NBA's nightmares. Somewhere in the stands, the ghost of Leo Ferris, Emil Barboni, and Dainé Baison smiled.
Around some people living their life in bottles. Granddaddy had the golden flask, backstroke every day in Chicago. Some people like the way it feels. Some people want to kill their sorrow. Some people want to fit in with the popular.